Hi.
Morning, fresh faces. So let's get started. Any more stragglers, you think? Or,
yes.
That's probably
maybe,
right.
Maybe more.
Okay. So, welcome to the Morning Valkyrie Talk. Welcome to the last day of Easterdam. My name's Andy Robinson. I work on Valkyrie. For the second time in a row, I've got the morning after the night before presentation. This year's Fanfest. I got the 10 a.m. after the pub crawl slot at Fanfest last year, which meant both the audience and myself was in terrible condition. Marge Simpson voices. It was all real bad. This is the Tears of Round Havoc. It's like an excerpt from the graphic novel that's a bit of a meme in our office these days whenever someone's upset about something this round. But yeah, so it's a little disappointing. But it's good to be here. I'm glad it's a great turnout. Thank you so much for coming to see us today. The other thing I need to apologize for in advance is, and this has been very honest, due to like some communication mix-up, I didn't realize I was doing a presentation this weekend. Like, I thought I was coming to Amsterdam to come and demo and just drink tons of beer and just chat to you guys and like find out what you thought about Valkyrie and just get to know people here. And then on Friday evening, they said, hey, like, what have you got for your presentation? And I went, presentation? So like, what I've been doing is just, you know, speaking to you over the last couple of evenings and afternoons, try to find out what you guys would like to hear about, find out what you want to know about Valkyrie. Try to put some slides together and talk about it. We'll do a big Q&A today. And yeah, so hopefully we can learn something and I've got enough stuff here to go over and everything will be just be okay. So welcome. Zed, I think we're gonna try and get like a little bit of a look behind the curtain of Valkyrie today. Like I can answer any questions about the studio, what we're doing, you know, like why we did it. A couple of questions I've had like over the last couple of days. I also want to tell you a little bit about the like a terminology I've used in presentations in the past. It's like front of house and back of house stuff. So as a story, Valkyrie is mostly a multiplayer game. It's a game that people play, you know, like that's where we've put a lot of our effort and energy into. But behind that, like to get this, like the setting for Valkyrie and to put all that stuff in there, like it's more, VR is more about than just about the technology. Immersion is only one part of it. The technology that you strap to your face and kind of look into, that's just one piece. Like that's a hardware solution. What we want to do with Valkyrie is also look at a kind of psychological aspect of that. You know, build a story, build a tangible world for everyone to go into. And with that, we have that with New Eden. Like that's a thing with EVE Online. We can pull these amazing stories, these amazing ships, these amazing characters, and put them into the game. So I want to talk a little bit today about how we do that, why we do that, and what it does to help Valkyrie become more than just a kind of a technological demo for virtual reality. It's not just like, oh, hey, this is a really cool piece of new tech, we should try it. But what we really want to do is above and beyond that. Okay. So as I said, I've been asking people and talking to people about what they want to know about Valkyrie. One of the questions I had was how this all came around, and I don't tire of telling this story, and I really hope that I don't sound like it's very self-serving, but people really want to know about the genesis of the Valkyrie project. So I just give you a little bit of background. Like, was anyone here for FanFest 2013? And get to play the first EVR demo.
I see you don't count.
That's great. Did you try the first EVR demo?
All day long.
All day long. That's amazing. So in the run up to that, like we had, as a group of friends, like me and three friends had got together. We got one of the very early Oculus Rifts, and I mean like it had like I think it was number like 16 or something written on the box. It was a very very early one. We backed the Kickstarter. We're a group of people who were just really excited about VR technology. We got together at a pub one evening and I started to scribble some images on a beer napkin and we talked about what we could do. We got together the next couple of days and just started building it. Like for us, we wanted VR to be a thing. We wanted virtual reality to become something. And it's very much a chicken and egg situation. If nobody makes great stuff for VR, then no one's gonna buy it. And then, you know, that's what we, you know, we wanted to put something on the platform that made people excited for VR. So that's really it. Like the first demos that came with the Oculus were pretty simple and didn't really do a lot and had a lot of motion sickness stuff. And we knew as game developers we had the kind of skill set to build something. And with Eve, we had this great platform to build. So we wanted to show Eve essentially from a different perspective. Like you guys are playing, you know, far away from the ships, wanted to put people front and center into the ships. So we started to build this kind of first person flying game. And you know, like it really spoke to the things that we enjoyed. You know, we've all played Descent and Elite and Lila Wars and all these kind of games when we were younger. So we wanted to put some of that back into the thing. So we got together. After a couple of weeks, the demo was coming together nicely and was looking kind of fun, and we were enjoying it. We took it up to some people at CCP and said, hey guys, like we've been working on this in our spare time. What do you think? They really enjoyed it and said, okay, how about you get this stuff together for FanFest? At that time, there was only 5 weeks to FanFest. We've been working for about 2 weeks. So the stuff that you saw at FanFest 2013 was really only 7 weeks of work. And that was seven all day, all night weeks of work, I would say. Like we were like working on EVE Online 9 to 5 at 5:01, just like pushing that work aside, starting work on EVR, working from 5:01 until 3, 4, 5, sometimes 6 in the morning to try and get it together to make sure that what we took to that first FanFest was something really special. Because we were building it for you guys. Like it was like it was supposed to be something that was gonna be FanFest 2013. That was it. Like it was like a one-off kind of thing. It's something just to show you a different side of EVE, and we'll see what happens after that. So we built it basically in 6 sleepless weeks. When we brought it, we showed like the journalists were there, and suddenly this thing just took off. Like it snowballed in such an incredible way. They played it. They really loved it. We somehow managed to keep it a secret from all of you, and I've still got no idea how we managed to do that at FanFest. Like, I know these little things kind of sneak out through a couple of days, and we were having to be very, very careful, like, not to talk about it, or, you know, when we went to bars in the evening or restaurants and things where everyone's hanging out, like, not to mention it too loud that there's going to be this VR project there. So I got the privilege of, like, sitting in the same theater with all you guys at the time when we showed the first trailer. And I'd designed the trailer, so we had that little like, kind of tease that there was EVE Online, then it went all dark, and then it appeared in the cockpit. And I was so worried, I was so nervous going into that about what people would think and how you guys would like kind of accept it. Like, is it really Eve? Is it something that you wanted to see? And I remember like sitting in that audience and seeing the bit where, you know, it's like, it goes all dark for a couple of seconds and then it kicks in and there's the breath and it's suddenly like a first person thing and you're flying the ship. And this guy, about like 2 rows behind me, went, oh shit! like all this crazy noise, and we showed the trailer a bunch of times, and so you got to play it the next day. Once again, the morning after the pub crawl, we took rudimentary early VR prototypes, showed about 1,000 people. There was a little bucket behind the stage just in case. We were confident in what we had done in terms of motion sickness, in terms of solving lots of problems with VR, but we were not confident that you guys hadn't drunk so much beers that you were going to be able to handle flying like 4 minutes in space. So yeah, the story really grows from there. Like your guys' passion for this is what built EVE Valkyrie. It's very much your game. Like, you know, there was some decisions to be made whether we took this any further. The journalists really enjoyed it, and that was one thing. You guys really enjoyed it, and you campaigned for it for us, and that was incredible. Like, for us, we had this great grassroots thing of people coming through who wanted to build a great VR game, who wanted to build a great EVE VR game, and that's what kind of pushed us through. We took it to E3 later, like a couple of weeks after that. Also blew away E3. We had a line, we had a little room in the back, and the queues grew like every day to the point where we had all these velvet ropes outside, and the guys from Witcher 3 came over and said, hey, blocking our game, man. Like, people couldn't get in. People like trying to get into CEVR because we were the only VR game that year. Like, there was literally, there was PS4 and there was Xbox One and there was like, you know, like Call of Duty 10 and Assassin's Creed 19 and stuff. And so, like, we were the first VR game to be there, represent CCP, represent the EVE community, and just trying to build something up for them. So that's really where it came from. I moved over from the Iceland office not long after that to the Newcastle team, who'd been doing the back-end stuff for Dust 514. They're a very, very talented group of about 15 programmers who knew Unreal like the back of their hand. And yeah, so that's where Valkyrie was born. And really, since then, it's just been a case of learning and building and hiring a team, getting more designers and artists in, people who are really passionate about VR, really passionate about building more onto the roof, you know, adding something extra to it, like adding this new dimension. My throat's getting kind of dry. So yeah, that's really the story of how Valkyrie came around. Like it's because of you people. It's because of all the EVE community really pushing it forward for us and getting it. And that's what we want to deliver, like a game that's both accessible for everyone else. We want to get more people into EVE, like especially with the PlayStation launch this month. We've seen this huge influx of people into the world. But also, like it's you know, it's for you guys as well. Like we're trying to get the ships that you love, you know, the experiences that you want to see, the things you want to fly around closer and explore more. You know, that's what it's really about for us to build. So, if you've got any questions on this, of course, there'll be a little bit at the end. We can talk about it a little further. So yeah, as I was saying, like we had to grow EVR into Valkyrie. And for me, like kind of my role in that, we talked a little bit about, or like I've used the terminology before, flesh it out, because what it was essentially like a 3-minute show floor demo. It was designed to be something that you could go to and sit and play for 3 minutes, which thank you all day, every day, for 3 minutes at a time, does a fan fest, but that needed to become something more. We couldn't sell, or we couldn't give like a 3-minute demo to people and have them, you know, be excited about it, or you know, keep coming back to it. What I wanted was a VR game that people would continue to come back to. But flesh out is not really the right word, because that makes it feel like we're trying to like tease out something that we had to make it more. What we really wanted to do was just build something great. We had this opportunity, we had a great head start in VR. So my job initially when I went over there was to sort of make a creative framework, like to start to build the backbone of what this game would become. And that doesn't mean throwing out EVE at all. It was about, for me, like coming from the EVE Online team, building upon it. So I'd worked in the art team for the past 3 years. I had a good knowledge of the like the ships and the visuals and the world. Like I really love story. Like story is the great backbone to all great games and stuff. And I really wanted to try and get as much of that in. I'm glad that we have our own little separate pocket of Valkyrie. Like it tells its own little story. It's part of the greater universe, but it really has its own little bits and pieces going on. You know, has its own identity, and we needed that. Like, we needed to be able to design a game that fit our game, but we really wanted to say, like, have as much connection with the main game itself. So, like, we're always in communication with Iceland. Like, we're always speaking to them about, like, you know, what are you guys working on? What are we working on? Where could we like fit these things together? You know, talking to the story team and passing bits back and forth. So this comes up quite often. Does a multiplayer game need a story? And that's, like, people say it to me all the time. I'm surprised how many people tell, like, say this to me. Like, it's a really, like, unusual question. And it's not, for me, it's not really been about, like, the cinematics or the trailers and stuff, although that's, like, a really nice thing. It's about, like, what our design and creative teams can put together. Like, although we're predominantly a multiplayer game, it's so nice to have context in the maps or context in the characters, you know? Like, you want to, as I said earlier on, like, it's not about just the technology. The technology is great, like, it removes a barrier between you and the television. Like, you no longer are you and the screen, the monitor. You're no longer just looking at that flat screen and kind of separate from it. Like, you're right inside it. But that's just one piece of the puzzle. Like, I think if VR developers don't look at this and approach this in a different way, VR is never going to take off. It's about the Aussie, you know, thinking about you inside the Aussie, like the locations of where things are coming from, really like transposing you from the outside world to the inside world. And the storyline is a big part of that. And that's something that I've been really working on recently. Like, if you saw the trailer from 2 years ago, which was Convoy, and then you got to play that Convoy out there, like, we built Convoy as a trailer, like as an awesome trailer, but we built it in Engine because all the stuff we did was to try and, all the trailers was about putting you inside that cockpit, you know, trying to give the sense of first person. And people said to us, like, at that fan fest, can I play this level? We were like, oh, no, we just built it for the trailer. And then we got back to the office, like, why did we just build it for the trailer? Why not build it for the game? Like, why not let people actually try it? So that gave birth to, like, a whole new kind of section of stuff, which I'll talk about soon. So I managed to grab a bunch of these. These are just, like, old mood boards and things I put together back when we were transitioning EVR into EVALKYRIE. I'm a big fan of this, like, as coming from an art background and moving into design space. Mood boards are, like, hugely important for me, so it's just, like, initially, the idea of this anonymous pilot, like, we didn't want there to be a character of Valkyrie, like, one person that you played as. I wanted you guys to play as yourselves. You know, people, when you get into the cockpit, it must feel like it's you getting into that cockpit, it's you that's flying around in there. So this anonymous pilot piece is something that was really, really important to us. The subculture, and this is something that I don't think we really built up a lot of kind of pirate lore so much yet in EVE Online, and it was something that I was really excited to be able to explore. So digging into this idea of the pirate subculture, how is that affected? How does it affect itself? What's happening there? What systems are they building? The idea in Valkyrie is that these guys are building the best fighters they possibly can. They're stripping down these ships. All the ships' cockpits are designed. You can see it's all pulled away stuff, augmentations, wires sticking out, things connected together. These guys are stripping out all the unnecessary systems, refining it down, and just making the nicest, sleekest battle cockpit they possibly can. And that's part of their subculture. So we built up this whole kind of theory and lore and story behind, you know, the Valkyrie pilots and where they came from and what their kind of ideology is and how that works. And that's something that we don't always necessarily get across to use. We're saying about this back of house, front of house story. We have all this stuff written and kind of here back for the creative teams, the art teams and design teams and games teams here. But we don't always manage to get all of that out to you. And that's what we're trying to do right now, is trying to get more of that story. Now we've got a base game, trying to get more of that story and stuff out to you guys and communicate that a lot better. But that's the thing that went into, you know, how we build the ships, how we build the people and the culture, the cockpits, as I was just talking about, really inspired by that stuff, cool old Russian sci-fi art, Hawking and Blade Runner, obviously, just leads into everything. I mean, we like space shooters. Space shooters seem to disappear for a number of years, or kind of went quiet for a number of years, and then recently we've seen this massive resurgence, just unfortunately at the same time as Valkyrie, so we've got lots of competition, but it's a good thing. It's a games that we love to play. That's partly why we made it as well, just because we wanted to see another great space shooter, a really focused space shooter. So that lore, the pieces that I put together initially went off to spawn the comics with Dark Horse Comics. And again, if you told me a couple of years ago that I'd be writing helping write the script and art edit a comic with Dark Horse Comics, it'd absolutely blow my mind. It's just incredible, it's insane. But yeah. So I put together a quick timeline, but you probably can't see that very well. I really need to release this out. I think in the next couple of weeks or so, I'm going to try and get some more things out and about the Valkyrie lore and this stuff is in, the stuff behind the curtain stuff that we're putting together. We're trying to put together a kind of structured timeline of when things happen and kind of bounce the player around to show you bits and pieces of that. But I'll try and do something quite soon in a blog, I think. Yeah, so this is the convoy trailer that we made into a level. I think I've already spoken about that earlier on, though. But it really does give you a snippet of the universe. It starts to build the characters a little bit. And for you guys, it gives you a chance to just fly beside these mammoth ships. It was something we aspired to get done, right back when we started. We really wanted to put you in the middle of a giant space war. That was what was really exciting to us, was to imagine just a huge battle, you being the smallest part of a huge battle, a massive, lasers and missiles firing off and stuff, and you just being in the center of that, you've got your people to fight and just dodging around, and that was something we really aspired to get done, so I was so pleased to get this as a piece in the game. That's also led on to Scout Mode, which is a piece like it. If you like to look at the full Valkyrie game, we put in a mode which has got no combat at all. It's really about just kind of flying around and exploring the world. And we put monologues in, like the Chronicles in Eve are awesome. Is anyone a fan of Chronicles? Do you guys read the Chronicles?
Yes.
They're good. Yeah. That's cool. I love them. I think the team that puts out like a story behind the game lets people like if they want to, if they choose to dig much deeper into the game. You know, like I'm one of those people when I'm playing games and rocking around like reading all the laptop terminals and listening to all the things and you know just trying to get like as much information and scraps and stuff about a game that I can because I want to feel like immersed in that world, and that's the idea behind Scout Mode for us and putting these kind of monologues in these audio diaries. Was that people would hear about the characters, like you can fly into each map and get a sense of why that map exists, like what happened to it. Like the one you showed earlier, like Convoy then later becomes Necropolis, like the aftermath of this. So the destruction that you see in the Convoy demo that we played this afternoon is a map further on, like in the timeline in Eve Valkyrie, where you fly out among the carcasses, like all the exploded ships, like it's all like foggy and soupy, and you can fly through all the like the smashed up bits of ship and like inside them and stuff. So we wanted to give the maps a bit more context rather than just saying, oh, this is a map, like this is the asteroid map and this is, you know, this nebula map and stuff. You know, we really wanted to build these maps that had like a bit of story behind them, just this creative backbone behind them. And the Scout Mode helps us achieve that a lot. So it's you know, like there's characters who've been there or part of that battle or you know, have information about the ships or like can call out landmarks that are of interest to you. So I was lucky enough when we had the idea to get Katie Sackhoff involved to write some script and put some stuff together for her. And the story of Katie Sackhoff coming into the project is really, you know, we talked in the office about like who would be a great voice for Valkyrie, who's a great voice for Ryan Cabot. We knew we wanted this like strong female lead for the game. It popped up, you know, some conversations were had at some level, but we took a demo, like a laptop and a headset out and showed her, and I saw the clips maybe at FanFest a few years ago, like it just, like she genuinely loves the game, like it totally blew her mind, she was excited to be part of the project and that was great for us. So that meant I had to start writing script for a famous Hollywood deep person, that was really scary and everything, but I've got a little excerpt of like one of the monologues here just to listen to.
Amongst the construction platforms and docking bays of this old shipyard lies a field of empty shells. Behind the blast doors and crosshatch metal frameworks, the failure of 1,000 pilot transfers. A reminder that despite my situation, my resurrection could have been more difficult. Fatal has testing facilities all over, working on new technology, advancing and refining. A proud empire on the fringes of science. Hidden from prying eyes. The amount of resources he controls under the guise of the Garistas is staggering. The only cure is to burn it to the ground.
It's cool, like, her voice is so great, and like it really fits what we're trying to get done here. So, like I love writing stuff for her, it's one of the best parts of the job, I'd say. And every protagonist needs an antagonist, I suppose, so we need someone to fight against, and we picked Fatal, someone from, you know, has a long history in Eve, died many, many years ago under mysterious circumstances, and that's given us a chance to give him a really great rebirth. We've had to really focus on Ron Kavik and kind of making her the center point of first. Like, we are a very small team and trying to put these things together, but we're going to see a lot more Fatal coming up in the future. We're going to tell more of his story, we're going to get him more involved, we're going to build up the tension between these two characters much more. And that's something we're really keen on getting, but I've also got some monologue stuff for him as well.
Amazing how circumstances change in just a few short years. I'm a man who prides himself on being in the loop, you see. The secrets and lies of a galaxy flowed towards me. An entrepreneur's real currency is knowledge, but with my death came a form of bankruptcy, a feeling of isolation that I am personally unfamiliar with. However, the challenges of this new world excite me. Shedding my notoriety has been a liberating experience. Working outside of the spotlight has afforded me new opportunities. I own more than just your indiscretions now. I own everything you are.
So the guy that records this legitimately sounds like this all the time, and he's awesome. And like I was going through all the different scripts and the different voice actors we have, and I found this guy who did like he'd done a ton of Jack Daniels adverts, and I was like, I just want him. Like I really want this guy here. So we called him and started speaking to him, and like he talks a little bit like this. He's like not quite as gruff as that, obviously, but like. He genuinely says this, and he loves the character of Fail. Like, he gets so into it. We've recorded a lot of stuff with him recently, a lot of monologues and stuff, and like, he's just so into the character. So, yeah, we're really hoping to be able to explore that a little bit more. I know it might be quite jarring, maybe at first, to have that kind of very southern accent. It's quite strange, but we didn't want to go with another generic accent, if that makes sense. Like, we don't want to just have, you know, this kind of middle of the road, you know, when you've got your main characters, you've got to have such a distinctive voice, like something that really jumps out. And when you're playing Valkyrie, when you start hearing him in Fails, like writing for Fails is the most fun person to write for. Like he's threatening, he says terrible things to you, he says he's doing terrible things to your clone while you're like off fighting. And like, I just love writing stuff for him, it's really great. So, but it's at first, I think some people are a little bit jarred by the voice, but over time you get used to it. It's about just being distinctive, about being strong and making strong decisions like this, that really like helps set these things up, rather than just going for like a, you know, that kind of middle of the road classic American voice or something, and having it kind of fade into the background. But you know, really picking somebody who can set up as a great character for Valkyrie. So he set up the schism. This is the logo. Some of these lovely badges. And again, this is something we're just building up, like the Valkyrie and the Schism like don't have a history in EVE Online, but we needed to have them in order to kind of set our path. You know, we needed to be able to define things for our own game, slightly kind of separate of EVE, but sort of within that EVE universe. So that's given us some opportunity to go in and do that. And we'll be looking to build up more Valkyrie kind of Schism stuff again in the story, like as the release moves on. There's also like a third kind of unknown character in it, which is essentially your PDA, the CAT system. I don't know if you guys have played Valkyrie, have Valkyrie Home on Oculus or PlayStation, but we've been kind of slowly building up the character who acts as the person who runs you through the menus and the user interface and things. She's a legitimate character to herself. She actually had hundreds and hundreds of lines originally that we cut down a little bit at the start just to stop confusion or to make sure, you know, but like the introduction to all the maps in the front end, the person that helps you through the training, she's a like a legitimate character to herself. She's a like an AI, an algorithm that was created for all the pilot transfers that never made it, being put into this like large kind of computer algorithm. So she is like a thousand voices of like a thousand dead pilots kind of combined and splashed together. And over the time, I'm really hoping to explore that more as a character as well. I think it's a great opportunity for that to have a little bit of communication with your, you know, she's almost like the voice in your head, but not. And so yeah, I'll be looking to build that up a little bit soon, hopefully. Okay, so I've talked a little bit about the framework and what that was to kind of put that stuff together, and then the backbone of how we built Valkyrie of EVR. I want to talk a little bit about some of the features that came off the back of that very quickly. So this is the clone bat room. One of the things that we really wanted to get, like the death scene, sort of like, I'm sure many people experienced it, like over playing the demos the last couple of days, that bit where we just kind of, you know, your ship explodes and you freeze. When we went around designing that, like it was one of the pieces that I worked on quite early on, with the glass smashing and the slow motion and the frozen body and stuff. That was something we were trying to do. Like, it's such a fast-paced game. You're always in action. You're always flying around. You're flying tons of missiles. People are flying missiles at you. You're like ducking under asteroids trying to go. So the death sequence and the clone bat room and the death is supposed to be like a moment of punctuation, like a moment of reflection. So you've got that little 5 or 6 seconds where it's just you and the ship. And it goes back to some of the mood boards I showed earlier on. Like, space feels quite a lonely kind of void at times. So yeah, just to try and kind of juxtapose the two things, to have like this crazy action game with all this stuff happening, and suddenly just have this moment to yourself where you're like, shit, I'm dead. I'll be back in a minute, but right now I'm dead. And like, why did I die? And how did I die? And what can I do to do better next time? I also helped us build the UI in the front end, and that's like hands up one of the hardest things we've had to do, like as VR developers, as one of the early VR developers and the people really pushing to get this stuff done, is how do we make the first great VR UI? Like, it's not a case of just throwing loads of menus up and you know, like having tons and tons of cats, lots of text. We can't really rely on the old systems of EVE Online. Like, we really have to design this from scratch and even start designing UI, you know, from scratch ourselves. Like, it's not something, there's no rule book for this stuff. Like, there's no, out there, there's not like a guide to like what's the best VR UI at the moment. Like, we're having to define that ourselves, and that's something the team's been working really, really hard on. This is the front end system, the idea that you are like perched up above like a section of your carrier, so you can look down and kind of see the world underneath it. We're busy kind of building that up and making that more customizable, allowing you to see more interactions that are happening within the ship. You saw the thing for the crow's nest earlier on, that I had up there. That's it. Like, if you, in the main game, like while you're looking at the UI, turn your head around 180 degrees, there's like a dodgy, like sketchy pirate bar behind you called the crow's nest. And that comes up a lot in the little bits of stories and stuff. So yeah, like it's about, this is again some old mood boards, some things I wanted to put together when EVR transitioned into Valkyrie, so lots of cool stuff, like point cloud stuff, and all these kind of futuristic unfolding geometrics and things. But that's the kind of style of stuff that we're looking to do, contextual interfaces, you know, things that are pop out and shoot out of things, like holographics, all that kind of stuff is really, you know, that's cool, and that's something, it's tangible, it's something, if you can see the context for where the UI comes from, you know, you can see the hologram comes up here and I can manipulate this stuff. That feels better in UI than just looking at like a big square and trying to, you know, run down it with a D-pad and pick options on and off. Like, we want stuff you feel like you can touch and you feel like you're making a difference to in the real world. Yeah, wireframes, that kind of stuff. So you can see how that sort of transitioned into even our kind of early stuff here. It's always creepy taking these pictures because you've got no head in VR, like you're the head. So anytime I take a screenshot outside of the body, there's just these like headless mannequins like roaming around the front end and like roaming around the ship. They're horrible to take. We had a bug recently actually in the scoreboard where the heads came off and like sat between your feet, like creepily, basically, like on Halloween day, like proper Sleepy Hollow stuff. Like, as soon as you got to the scoreboard, you just were like, okay, that's my score, that's my ship. Where's my head? Oh my god, like down between your feet. Like, it was so strange, I don't know like where it came from, but yeah, proper creepy. So you can see we tried to build this sort of like 360-degree UI, like a UI that felt like you were inside a bubble and you were controlling stuff in that bubble. That's the Iron Man dream, right? Like the Iron Man manipulating things around you. Like, we're a little bit of a way off that yet. And to be honest, the Iron Man UI stuff is overly complicated. You know, it's filmic, it's cinematic, like there's so much stuff there that is nonsense. It's like spinning circles and things that fly out and stuff. That's not a good usability user interface, unfortunately. We have to strip away all that kind of stuff and keep it, you know, to the stuff that you really need to do. You need to understand like how you move through this interface, like how you breadcrumb through these different parts. But yeah, that's something we really kind of tried to do. And even from here, we've made, like, since these screenshots are taken, this thing's changed like probably 10 times just from, you know, grabbing people and getting feedback. And feedback from shows like this, like the things that you guys tell me when you play these demos outside, I genuinely take back to the office and we talk about these things. Because VR is really about getting it on people's heads, like, you know, getting that kind of feedback and stuff. So if you do have anything you want to talk to me about today, things you liked or disliked, then please let me know. We have forums and things up and running now as well. You can jump on the Valkyrie forums, you know, like, let us know what you think, let us know, like, things you'd like to change. But yeah, so, like, this is cool to wrap around. We've got like the, see the quartermaster up there on the right hand side, like another character again that I really want to bring into the game. The guy who like built the original Wraith fighter in our story and our lore is like building these kind of cannibalized, bastardized like ships. You know, they're all like they're designing stuff like the Wraith is basically like a blended Templar and Dragonfly. And it is that for me it was initially purely because of the VR stuff. Like I wanted to see the wings like shoot out in front of you and stuff. But you know, we like this guy's kind of building himself up as a bit of a powerhouse in our story, where he's the guy sort of designing these like, super cool fire ships and stuff for the Valkyrie and the Schism as well. He doesn't work for either side, but he works for both. But yeah, it's cool. So like the VR, you look around, you can start picking things out. You know, like holograms shoot in and shoot out of places. You know, like it's all dynamic, like all the stuff shimmering and moving around you. There's lots of like waves and cool stuff happening. So it's a shame we don't have a demo actually. You can see it today, but. Yeah, if you buy it, okay, so just quickly, I've been rambling on for such a long time. The state of the game is out, it came out on, it launched on Oculus, it's a huge boon for CCP and us like to get into this VR thing so early. Like, genuinely, people seem to have painted us as this like these VR leaders or people who are like really pushing this technology forward, and that's a great place for us to be, and that's a great place for EVE Online to be in and CCP to be in. We released on PSVR on the 13th of October. We were a launch title for that. We made a disc. There was a disc in the shops. Can you imagine? Like a thing I drew on a beer napkin 4 years ago is now a disc in the shops. You can see, like that's completely blown my mind. We managed to get the Oculus and the PSVR together, so they're all in one server. Everyone plays together. It's no like mouse and keyboard versus joypad versus joystick or that kind of stuff. Right now, you know, everyone's kind of equal, so we can put these things together without a problem. So all the PC players and all the PlayStation players are all playing together. The communities are getting on incredibly well. People are, you know, playing the Oculus for a long time, so they're teaching the new PSVR guys how to play, and there's a really lovely community coming out of that stuff. People have spoken to me this weekend about like configuration, like changing the buttons. They're not happy about it being, you know, in the one inverted flight, or they would like, you know, the other stick to be the movement stick and stuff. That's something we've heard for like a little while now, and we've put like a lot of stuff in so you can start changing the controls on the PSVR and on the PC version. Flight stick support has been coming in gradually. We're putting in lots of different flight sticks because, again, from you guys, every time we did these shows, FanFest especially, people are saying, like, I want to get my like my joysticks and stuff in, and that's cool. Of course, we'll get that stuff. We have a Trello board where we have all the ideas, basically, that we get from events like this. And you put them on the Trello board, and it shows you, like, our roadmap, what we're working on. And, yeah, we're just going to keep supporting the game. Like EVE Online, where you're always getting these updates. We want to do the same thing. Like if you buy the base game, we're going to continue to add maps and ships and single player recall missions and more scout mode missions and, you know, everything that there is in the game. There's plans to build up and build up over time. It has been a very like challenging development process being such early people in VR, so in a small studio. So the game we got out is sizable, but you know, we feel we can do more with it, we can add more to it, so we're going to be adding stuff, like not pay for DLC at the moment, but just like keep adding more and more free stuff. You saw we added Carrier Assault at FanFest this year, that was just us. You know, we got the game out for Oculus and we're like, we need a new map, we need a new cool mode, we want something that kind of envisions that trench run feel of Star Wars. We were just kind of flying down and like destroying, like we wanted to destroy a bigger ship, basically. Like, we destroyed a lot of ships that are my size, now I want to destroy a ship that's like way bigger than me, so that was cool. And yeah, we're just going to continue on in that vein, just keep adding more stuff, keep taking requests, and you know, hit as much stuff we can. The Trello board today has lots of stuff there. There's also a lot of secret things going on, and announcements will be coming soon. I think some new things, new maps and stuff coming up before Christmas and early in the new year, and lots of other things. So thank you very much. Sorry if it was a bit of a like mishmash of lots of other stuff. Like, I've done lots of presentations, luckily, like around the world with VR recently. I just managed to grab loads of slides and lots of different things, smoosh them together, hopefully give you guys a little bit of an idea of what it's been like to build it over the last 4 years, what the studio is like. If you have any questions, now is the time.
thanks for the presentation. Did you have any problem like with scale, and what was the hardest kind of ships that you could envision actually build from scale from the point of a pilot?
That's an excellent question, actually. That's really good. Scale is a hugely important thing in VR. And mostly because it defines the speed at which you travel, or the sense of speed at which you travel. Like, it's all about how fast you feel you're going. So, like, to make a map, the level design stuff, and I'm sure, like, Starbucks spoke about this last year, she did some level design stuff, you know, you really have to pass by objects of various sizes to make it feel like you're traveling very quickly. So, like, if we just put, a Titan straight in, it feels like it's such a long, drawn-out experience to fly past that Titan, because it's, like, in proper Eve scale, which the game is very close to, it just feels like an eternity. You know, he's traveling inside the ship for hours. You know, I think we did a time thing. It was something like 14 minutes or something. Like that's not sure. So what you had to do is try and break up the levels to have like different frequency of details, so small details, medium details, like large details. So if you fly past like a fairly large ship, and then two small asteroids, and then like a smaller ship. You know, that sense, okay, like this is taking me this long to travel, and then I zip past this, and then, so that gives you that sense of speed, it gives you that feeling, sorry, I'm moving away from the microphone, it gives you that feeling that you're genuinely, traveling around, much quicker. The scale that we mostly do, so we have been taking a lot of assets directly from EVE Online, we do them at 1.5 scale, and that's just the stuff that we've kind of hit in the engine is the sweet spot for this stuff, that's where it's slightly exaggerated in terms of one-to-one, so it just feels a little bit bigger than it should be, but that's what feels the nicest, through our tests, and that's what felt good. When it comes from bringing stuff across from EVE Online, EVE Online is an old game now, there's a heritage of stuff. Some stuff is great to bring over, you can just import, do a little work on, put it on Unreal. Some stuff is so old. Some of the coolest stuff we find is just oh man, it's two generations ago with art tools and stuff. So we try and rebuild as much as we can, for our stuff, so that the sense of detail holds up. When you fly up really close to something, obviously things in Eve are textured to be quite far away, so we want to texture stuff so it's quite close up. So a little bit of work on getting some of those things, and it's not just a direct flip across. But thank you, man. No problem. Any more questions, drunkies?
I have a question, actually. You mentioned the various storyline elements and are introducing them. So, do you have any concrete plans for the near future on how to bring more of these stories to players, not perhaps just developers, but also EVE Online?
Any plans to bring them where? Somewhere? In the game or?
No, just externally. Just in front of the players of either game.
The graphic novel was the first kind of piece where we had the chance to break out. I don't know about any other external media stuff at the moment. Obviously the game is multiplayer focused, but people really like these recall missions. So Convoy is now one of five recall missions in the game. So there's five more that are similar, if not, I think most of them are actually bigger or longer than Convoy. So they're pieces that you can, explore. Focus has always been on, to make sure the multiplayer game was tight, it was a really great game, but we'll be putting more of those in. With every map we release four new audio logs or four new chronicles, so vocalized chronicles, so more story in that respect. But I'm not really sure about other stuff, outside of the game, what opportunities we've got to tell more story with this stuff. But I need to try and get writing stuff. I'm so focused on the game that I try to get more things outside, so more forum posts, more dev blogs, there are things with the timeline and trying to help explain some of this stuff the best I can. So that's on me to get done.
Okay, cool.
Hi. I was playing the demo yesterday. It was really great to see myself in the cockpit. I was like, oh my god, I have boobs. Well, this is great, it's also a little bit distracting. is there any way that you are going to build into the game some kind of character customization? Also because of immersion and your good point about it's yourself in the game.
Absolutely. So there is a male and female selection choice now in the full game. The reason that we had the female body like ready for these analytics and like quite a few of the demos that we show was because we built out Brown Cabin first. Like this, it's basically this body that you're seeing here that you're playing, because we built out for cinematic purposes. And then we had to, so we kind of were like, we've got this body, we need to build a male one, but we don't have time, so we just had to make it one female, which is great to see like a fan festival of like 10 people all just playing the game. Guys, remember, move your head as much as possible, like this is an immersive world where you can look anywhere you want.
Yeah. Maybe next time I'll come
out to it. But yeah, so there's a, like this male
thing with pilot made choice. Boobs.
Pilot customization. It's something to keep an eye out for. Wink. Wink.
Yeah, I got you. I actually have another question. I definitely want to buy this game. Now you have the PlayStation 4 Pro. I know that's going to improve the quality, or at least there is the option for game designers to improve the quality of the PS4 VR glasses. Are you going to do that for this game?
Man, you're putting me in hard spots. we haven't announced a PS Pro patch yet.
Wink.
That's very not a very satisfying answer.
It's very political.
Yet.
Yeah. Door somewhere I can exit. Yeah, there is not a PS4 Pro patch yet.
Okay. I'll take that. Thank you. Hi there.
Hello.
I want to ask something. I haven't yet played the full game like when I own it, but I've heard from reviews that it's also got microtransactions inside of it. Now, I'm sure that is this true? I suppose it's true.
It does not have microtransactions. There is like, so this is something, yeah, that's a really divisive kind of thing, but like there was at some point, I think, some pieces in, but we pulled them out. Like it's still possible to buy the silver, to buy like the customizations for the ships in the game. So you can like, you can buy some on the PlayStation, you can buy some silver to buy like a skin for the ship or something if you wanted to get that soon. But there's no microtransactions in terms of like, getting your player upgrade or any kind of advantages or anything anyone can buy. It's just a piece, it's just a kind of straightforward thing. You know, like if I wanted to get this, hold of these pretty graphics right now, I can get all these pretty graphics too. But really, you can just, you buy and play the base game, you can be on a completely level food with everyone in the thing.
Awesome.
So, yeah, we just, it was, we didn't want that in the game. It's not, especially as a, like, it's a full price game as we are. There's, you can't be putting microtransactions into a game like that. So, although there is like options to buy currency, there's no microtransactions.
Super, thanks a lot.
No problem. Okay. Thank you very much for getting up early and the hangover. I hope you had a great party last night. And yeah, have a brilliant last day in Amsterdam. Thank you very much.
Somebody can play the elevator music real quick. We can switch things up.
Follow that.
Oh, please pick one.
I'm not biased to her.
Yeah. prices. Let's see. So, I was thinking, you know, morning after going out and party might be appropriate price to hand out. Skill injectors, you know, so you can get back some brain cells. They were sponsored by Iron Riders or Dodgy Bob, and by Amy Muffin, who sponsored the Six Blacks. So that was really cool. If they're not here, but give them a pause. So I believe I updated the slide. So this happened again. So are any of those people here to put on the list?
One of the seven.
Hold on. Congratulations! That was surprisingly easy.
The early bird gets the worm. Yeah,
nice. So then Lenny Kravitz sponsored two packages, but you get one of all four Marauders. So that's really nice. So this is the witness. Like, are you one of you here? No? Sorry. Let's see. Which number would be 16? 16? Actually, I'll know if it was.
16 is not here.
Kai Harms, are you here? Is that one of them? Yes. So, who's gonna win? I guess we could. Let's do the random thing then. She's winning. Awesome. Okay. Congratulations. And so we have one again, and that's Yen from something. Are you here? It's Natty. Oh God. Go for it, man. Congratulations. My presentation is at 1, so hopefully you guys can like drink something and then see you guys there. So, have fun.